Hi everyone, this is Roland. Today I want to talk to you about how to be fully awake and aware. First of all, I want to read you something from Madame Guillaume. This is from her well-known book about prayer. And chapter 9 is about putting off the old. She says, "I now want to address those dear souls who are still having problems with their old self nature and its desires." And she goes on to say that there's kind of a battle that goes on continuously between the old self and the new self, or between your higher consciousness and the lower. Up until the time when enlightenment begins to dawn, the older self is all you knew. The old nature with its desires and its rages and its angers and its willfulness and its resentments and its worries and its insecurity. That's all you knew. And the desires seem to be the way to success, or to find something that you're looking for. Desires to get away from the old and your old way of life, to get away from home, to get away from your parents, to get away from your boyfriend, to find a new boyfriend or find a new girlfriend or make more money, or get a new job or a new car, or a new phone or something. You see a change. So you always desired that, which is understandable. That's all, you know, that's all you knew. And it's not wrong. But the only thing is, it's not the answer. The answer is to find the new. Well, if you've been listening to my radio program, watching some of my videos, and you like where I'm coming from, maybe you've tried my little meditation, then you're starting to come up in awareness. You may be just getting started, taking your first little baby steps, putting a toe in the water, or you may be well along the way. Or maybe you're well along the way without even having ever watched any of my stuff or read any of my books or anything. But somehow you're on the way. Well, but the old nature is, some of it is still there. And it rises up, and you have to learn how to deal with it. Well, Madame Guillaume here goes on to say, she said, "Harshness and denial of pleasures may only serve to weaken your body rather than dull or eliminate your sensual activity." So in other words, like I always say, struggling doesn't do you any good. No, you don't want to throw in the towel and just give into it and say, "Well, I'm just a sensuous blob of this or that." No, you don't want to do that. But then on the other hand, struggling and trying to repress it, it doesn't work. So what you have to find the way of understanding and the way of watching. But here's what she says that I think is so good. She says that basically what you need to do is to have a genuine. She said the only genuine means of bringing about change is by inward means. You must commit yourself wholly to God and put yourself totally in His hands. This simple act of commitment in every circumstance where self exerts itself will, in time, produce a separation of the sensual from the spiritual. A separation of the sensual from the spiritual. That's very important. So let's talk about that. A separation of the sensual from the spiritual. See, your problem now, to some extent or to a large extent, depending on how far along the way you are, your problem is that you don't clearly see the separation. And you have to clearly see, all right, that you can actually stand back and watch. You can watch a wrong thought or a desire or some impulse that's rising. You can watch it. Stand back and watch it. And you'll see whether it's proper or not. If it's not proper, just watch it until it diminishes or goes away. Now, you know, for example, the example I always give of the office manager. When I worked in San Francisco in the financial district, it was kind of an old-fashioned office where people basically wore white shirts and ties. And the office manager sat at the front and he watched everybody. Most of the desks faced forward, just like being in school. And the office manager's desk was the only one that faced toward the other way. And so he could watch everyone. Now, he had his own activities and work and things to do. So he wasn't watching everybody, you know, constantly. But everybody minded their P's and Q's. People basically came back from their coffee breaks and lunch on time. They basically limited or didn't do any personal phone calls. They didn't sit around reading magazines or surfing or, you know, shopping on Amazon. They basically did their work because he was watching. You see what I mean? And then if he left for a while and was gone, then after a while, maybe there would be some naughtiness. But the moment the door opened and here he is, then everybody is back to being proper again. You understand? So there's a great value in just watching or being watched. Now, if you are close to your conscience, then it watches you. It restrains you. Let's put it that way. It's not so much as watches you, but it holds you back. And you, loving conscience, loving truth, loving what's right, you are in agreement with that. And the thoughts are still there, the naughty thoughts occasionally, or the mean thoughts. And you watch them, and you might even be able to see that they're not your thoughts. See, that's the real good separation. You know, in exorcisms, in real exorcisms, a lot of them are phony or fake or hypnotically induced, but there are some real ones. For example, Father Malachi Martin was a real exorcist. And there are some now, but I'm just using him because I've read his book, Hostage to the Devil, and so on. And I've listened to him. He used to be on Coast to Coast, you know, when Art Bell, and he used to talk. He's a real exorcist. And in every exorcism, there comes a moment of separation when the person mentally stands back and the bad is still there and the person is free. They are made free by God, by Christ. And the exorcist is just there kind of facilitating the process. And then the person is free. And they can say yes, yes to God. And they can say no to the bad guy. There's a moment of separation. So that's very important. But anyway, getting back to Madame Guillaume, a separation of the sensuous from the spiritual. So when there's a clear separation, then it's there, but it no longer rules you. You're no longer subject to it. See, that's the difference. So now that brings up another topic that I just want to tell you about. Yesterday, my work has quieted down quite a bit of late. The boss says that it has something to do with the internet, with SEOs or something, and we're somehow not coming up high enough on when people do a search for the service. So the work is calming, which usually does at this time of the year anyway, a little bit. But anyway, there's a lot less work. So I was home yesterday, didn't have any work. Can you imagine? So I was I was doing a bit of research about hypnosis, and I came upon a YouTube video, a YouTube movie. And the hypnotist is Paul McKenna, McKenna. It's an old television show. He actually made a it was on, you know, network television, probably, I don't know, 30 years ago or 40 years ago. But it's really good. And it's, I want you to watch that. If you don't do anything else, watch it. First of all, it's fun. It's entertaining. There's some really good music in it. And there are people who are hypnotized to dance like Elvis Presley or like Michael Jackson. It's just really, really, it's funny and it's fun, but it illustrates how a person can be, can do something that they don't even know what they're doing, or they actually think that they're doing a particular thing when in fact it's just been suggested to them. It's just absolutely mind-blowing and astonishing. Some of you are somewhat familiar with, but you've got to watch this one. So I'm gonna put the link underneath this video because you've got to watch it. And watch it more than once. I mean, it's entertaining, it's fun entertainment in and of itself. But I want you to really see. But the good thing about it is that these people are doing, and it's well produced, even though it's from an older television show. It's very well produced, and then after they have showing the person doing what they're hypnotized to do, then they have a little inserted picture of the person watching that and saying, "Oh my God, I can't believe I did that." And they talk about it. So it's absolutely fascinating, but I want you to see it. And then you can think back on your own life. Think of the things you've done, the people you've been involved with, the foolish mistakes you've made. And then you can ask yourself, is there a possibility that I was in a trance, that I was hypnotized, that I came under the influence of something? And of course, the answer is yes. But I want you to see that. It's just fascinating. And so they tie in together. So I want you to see that the new person, let's say you come up in awareness through getting closer to God, and there's that separation. And now you can look at things objectively and discern. And watch, and you're not caught up in things. You're less emotional and calmer. Then in that state, you can't be hypnotized. You're subject to God. But when you fall into what Madame Guillon calls the sensuous or the sensual, when you fall to that lower level, there, you can, not only can you be hypnotized, but you probably are, because you're subject to what? You're subject to everything. Every little stimulus, every little thing, you react to it. And suggestions, you're very suggestible, and so on. So ipso facto, automatically, it's called original sin. It's called the fallen state of mind. And from that fallen state of mind, then comes the old man, or the old person, as Paul called it. And that's what you were. Now, you're a new creature, subject to God, not to the hypnotist. You understand? So this is very, very good stuff. So please, if you can, watch that video. I really recommend it. See, there are a lot of them on YouTube. Stage hypnotists, that's usually the best. To me, it's kind of boring watching somebody hypnotize somebody in an office or something. I'm not interested in hypnotic techniques or anything, even though I understand them. Not interested. But I like it when there's a stage hypnotist, especially one like this Paul McKenna in that television program I just talked about, or maybe Anthony Gailey, who does a lot of corporate shows. You know, and corporations have their conventions and so on, and he does a hypnotic show. And so it's clean. It's good fun. It's not, it's within the bounds of taste. And it's entertaining. So I think that'd be a good introduction to you to see the reality of this fallen state of being, where we're subject to the world, slaves to the world. See, hypnosis is the mechanism. One of them, I mean, but it's the main one. So you definitely have to, if you have an interest in such things at all, then you should watch that. Okay, that's all I have to say. And enjoy the beautiful fall.